Good evening. My name is Pastor Kyle Winter. The following is a service of evening prayer for Wednesday, April 1st, as we are gathering in our homes due to the quarantine restrictions for the coronavirus. Greetings to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. I miss you all and am looking forward to the day when we get together again, together in the church that I'm standing in. We are going to be using our service of evening prayer that is sent to you and also linked in our YouTube page and on our Facebook page. I'd encourage you to follow along. At any point, you're able to pause this and pray together. You're able to take up these parts together. If you want to sing by yourself without me, more power to you. If you want to take the prayers yourself, more power to you. I'd invite you to listen to the sermon, pray together, sing together. The point of this whole thing is to bring Christ into our homes and to gather as one in the Spirit in the midst of a time where we can't be together. So I pray it blesses you, and if you are so inclined, you're able to share this as a tool for evangelism with those who are outside of our church or those who you feel would benefit from it. We're going to begin this evening with Psalm 90. I'm going to read a few verses from both the beginning and the end of Psalm 90 to prepare our hearts for worship, and then we will sing together the song, Abide With Me. So, to start with Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, O Lord. How long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all of our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to your children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. We're going to begin by joining together and meditating and singing the words of the hymn, Abide With Me. This is hymn 878. If you have a Lutheran service book, you can go there. If not, it's printed on the sheet for you. If you don't have either of those, you're welcome to just meditate and sing with the words that you know, or hear these words and be blessed by them. Deepens. As night draws near, let us fill our hearts and our homes with the promises of the Lord. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, the light that no darkness can overcome. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Whoever follows him will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. In him there is no darkness at all. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, the light that no darkness can overcome. Lord, let your light scatter the darkness and fill your church with glory. Let's pray together. Be present, O merciful God, and protect us through the hours of this night, so that we, who are wearied by the changes and the chances of life, may find our rest in you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to share a reading now from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 10 through 12. The theme for this week is Thy Will Be Done, focusing on the Lord's will and our obedience and submission and glad invitation of that will. And these verses are about God's will, that Christ himself would come and live and lay down his life and die and rise again for us. Hear these words. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge of righteousness, my servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great. He will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors. A second song called Go to Dark Gethsemane. Many of you are familiar with it. It's hymn 436 in our Lutheran service book. And it is a meditation to view the life and obedience of Christ and to follow in it. So each stanza of this hymn closes with a meditation to view Christ's life and actions and obedience as guidance for our own lives and our own obedience to Christ's will and to the will of God. So each stanza ends with a phrase like this: "Turn not from his griefs away, learn from Jesus Christ to pray." Or, "Shun not suffering, shame, or loss. Learn of him to bear the cross." So that in viewing the life and the act of will of Jesus Christ, we may see a way for our own lives and our own hearts to follow in obedience of him.
Go to Gethsemane, ye who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see. Watch with him one bitter hour, turn not from his griefs away.
A second reading from the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 2, verses 3-6. And again, this meditates on the will of God for his people. One of the fundamental kind of hearts and wills and desires of God for all mankind. Hear these words not only for yourself, but also for the whole world. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wills that all men would be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men. The testimony given in its proper time. We're going to now join in our confession of faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I would invite you now to take a few moments in prayer as you recall and remember the many needs of our world, of our nation, and of our community that need prayer. We have a God who heals. We have a God who hears. We have a God who longs for people to find hope and salvation in his name, and a Holy Spirit who changes and directs our hearts back to God. I would invite you to think about all of the people who are longing for something to hope in these days as we live in sort of a world that doesn't have a lot of hope, that sees sickness and illness all around and is looking for something to cling to for security and hope. I would lift those people up in prayer and ask that God would turn their hearts back to himself as our one security and hope and life and meaning in all of the world. So you can pause the camera and join with whoever you have around you, or if you are by yourself, I would just join in prayer with the in the spirit of God with the church, and pray for all of those who need the hope and the salvation and the security of Christ this day. And then in a moment, you can unpause the video and we will join in the Lord's Prayer together. So with boldness and with confidence, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A final reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 39 through 46. This reading comes from Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane as he prays in anguish prior to his passion, suffering, death, and resurrection, and submits himself to the will of God. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." And he withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, and he knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed even more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer, he went back to his disciples, and he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation." Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We continue with our series on the Lord's Prayer. Tonight we come to the third petition, namely, "Thy will be done." I always wonder if we really want to pray this petition or not. You know, sometimes we think of that phrase, "Thy will be done," as just sort of a resigned afterthought to throw in at the end of our prayers. Once we've said, "Lord, here are the things that we really want and desire for you to do for me and for our world," we kind of say, "But we know that you probably won't answer them," and so we'll tack on "Thy will be done" at the end as sort of a disclaimer. It's like we're bracing ourselves for the inevitable disappointment when God doesn't come through for us. But we know our prayers are supposed to sound pious, and so a little "Thy will be done" at the end kind of does the trick. I really think that that is a minimalist view of this petition, and we are undervaluing it when we use it that way. There's a lot more going on here than a mere escape clause for when our prayers don't come true. And the way that Jesus places this petition in the structure of the Lord's Prayer teaches us just that. He doesn't use it as a pious, resigned afterthought at the end. He doesn't say, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And deliver us from evil, but thy will be done." He doesn't use it that way. No, Jesus places it right up front, along with the two other petitions we pray at the opening of this prayer. "Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done." This is how Jesus would have us start the prayer, to get our priorities in place. If we're first oriented towards God's name, and then we're oriented towards God's kingdom, then God would have us be oriented toward his will. And that will shape the rest of our prayer concerns, I think, in a good way. So when we pray, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," I think if we're honest, we are aware of how God's will, even as we pray it, is not being done. In petitionary prayer, I think we're always kind of setting ourselves against the status quo or the norm of the world around us. If it's a world filled with cancer and viruses and human trafficking and greed and broken families, and that just seems like the way things are, then petitionary prayer that says, "Thy will be done," invites us to imagine and call upon God to bring about a different world. The world as God ultimately meant it to be. A world in which those things, cancer, viruses, illness, the whole lot, are not normal, but profoundly abnormal. To pray, "Thy will be done," is to adopt an appropriate distress over the world as it exists now, and to hold on to the conviction that God will, even now, begin to change the world. So as we pray for God's reign and God's rule and God's will to become fully visible, we are asking for God's perfect kind of wholeness to come upon the earth. I always think of Psalm 57, verse 5, where the psalmist cries, "Let your glory be over all of the earth." We are, in effect, praying that prayer of the ancient Psalms when we say, "Thy will be done." But how does that happen? How does God respond to our asking for his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven? Martin Luther in his catechism says this. He says, God's will is done when he breaks and hinders every evil plan and purpose of the devil, the world, and our sinful nature, which do not want us to hallow God's name or let his kingdom come or for his will to be done. And when he strengthens us and keeps us firm in his word and faith until he dies, that's God's good and gracious will for us. But in order to answer this question, how does God's will come, in a deeper and maybe in a more profound and mysterious way, we once again have to look at how Jesus himself demonstrates in his own life what it means to pray this prayer. On the eve of his crucifixion, Jesus prays in the way he had earlier instructed his disciples to pray in the Lord's Prayer. He kneels down in the Garden of Gethsemane, heavy with the weight of the world and with the plan of salvation that he was about to embark on his passion. And he prays these words, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet, not my will, but yours be done. My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Twice in the book of Matthew, and then recorded also in Mark and in Luke, Jesus prays against his own earthly desires to not receive pain and the hardship that would come with the cross, but ultimately submits himself to the will and the way and the desire of God. And the way that that prayer is answered, of course, the way the Father's will comes to be done on earth in that hour, is that Jesus is not rescued from his fate. He is arrested, tried, bound, scourged, and crucified, and then later vindicated on Easter. But this doesn't look like the peace of heaven dispelling the darkness of earth that we think we're praying for and desiring for when we pray, "Thy kingdom come." It actually looks like the reverse. What should we make of that? More pointedly, maybe, how ought Jesus's prayer in Gethsemane shape our understanding of God's will coming to be done on earth? Just so, in a world marked by sin and death, for the will of God, the wholeness, life, and love of God to take root on earth, it requires the vanquishing of that sin and death. It won't do to say that God is only found in moments of obvious health and beauty and joy. God must also be found at work in suffering, in darkness, in sickness, because the triumph of God's love can be assured only if God confronts the horror we've made of the world and bears it and removes it. I think what's even less intuitive, but what Gethsemane and later Calvary force us to notice, is that the will of God includes the road of suffering, struggle, hardship, dying, mockery, being rejected. That's strangely what it looks like for God's will to be done on earth at times. I'm always struck by the words in Psalm 23, those really familiar words. They come back into my mind, into my heart very regularly whenever I face trial and hardship and struggle. Hear these words, you recall them. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." I'm always struck by that little tiny word, "through." Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I will fear no evil, for you are with me." I think that that's what's happening as Jesus prayed his prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, and where the will of God is enacted in the life of Jesus, is that Jesus is going through the valley of the shadow of death with his people, with his loved ones, with his sheep, guarding, protecting, watching over them, and bringing them out of the most, of the greatest hardship, the greatest suffering, the greatest sickness, the greatest rejections, and bringing them to victory even in the midst of suffering. It's a beautiful and profound way of thinking about the will of God. And I think that's what's happening when we pray for the will of God to happen, is that God is not only giving us victory over sin and death and the devil, but also working through it and in the midst of it for his own victory and purposes as well. Perhaps maybe here is a good place also to pause and ask, why we petition God in general? Why do we ask God to do things? If the Christian tradition is right to call God unchanging, right, then why do we ask God to act according to and with our prayers? Is it the case that our asking for God's kingdom to come and will to be done on earth is what moves God to usher in the kingdom and assert his will? I don't really think so. Martin Luther was one of the many Christians who saw clearly that the point of petitionary prayer is not to try to convince God to do something he otherwise wouldn't do. Luther insisted that instead, asking for God's kingdom and will to be made manifest, which they would be, is about stretching our hearts so that they may learn to desire truer and greater realities. Or as C.S. Lewis said, "I pray because I can't help myself. I pray because, in fact, I am helpless. I pray because the need flows out of me at all times, waking and sleeping. My prayer doesn't change God, but instead he changes me." And I think that that is at the heart of "Thy will be done," is for us to ask for God to change the world around us to conform to his will and his desires, and also for us to ask him to change our hearts, our lives, our perspectives, our world, for his will and for his good. So as you pray this week, I pray that "Thy will be done" would gladly be the first thing that you pray, not the last thing that you pray, and that you would be confident that God's will is being done through all sorts of ways, and even in the midst of suffering, in the world and in your own life too. May the Lord's will be done, and the Lord bless you this coming week.
Amen.
I invite you now to take a few moments to talk about or think about or pray, join in prayer about the subjects that you heard. It's just a moment for you to react to the sermon and to talk together about it. And then we'll close with a song, the last two stanzas of "Abide With Me."
shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's faint shadows flee. In life, in death, O Lord, abide with
me. Receive this benediction from the Lord. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit abide and remain with us now and forevermore, until the day of his return. Amen. And I leave you again with these words from Psalm chapter 4, verse 8. I will lie down, and I will sleep in peace, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. The Lord bless you and keep you this evening. We'll see you on Sunday. I invite you now.